Good morning. Make your way into the what do we call this
room? I don't know.
Room? I forgot the name of it. The Chapman. Yes. As you're out front. Come on in. Come on in. We're starting. Lord, I find you in the seeking. Lord, I find you in the doubt. And to know you is to love you, and to know so little else I need you. Oh, how I need you. Oh, how I need you. Oh, how I need you.
Been held in your hand from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so God. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Yeah. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down and surrendered, running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered, I'll give you everything. Your goodness is running after, running after me. So my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
Yeah, praise God. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead. Amen. When I think of the goodness of God today, I'm thinking of His goodness as it is exhibited through the lives of other people. And today is a milestone moment for our church post-COVID. And that is that today we were able to expand into two different services. And we've needed to do that for a while because I'm telling you, even today, a lot of people text me yesterday, we're out of town. If everybody shows up on one day, we would have been in trouble. Now we're not in trouble. Now we've got space, and this is the beginning of great things. Despise not small beginnings, amen. And what's glorious is during both services, we've got people, much like this band, that are saying, hey, we want to serve, we want to magnify Jesus, we want to glorify God. So in all kinds of different capacities, there are people that are living, literally giving their time and their energy and their heart to serve, to help make this happen. One of those is this band. I want you guys to give it up for this band one more time. And our production in the back, they're killing it. Let's pray together. Father, we love you, we bless you, we thank you. You are a great and an awesome God. Thank you for the people that I got to talk to that were leaving after the first service and how the songs just raptured their hearts, God, and you brought them close to you. How glorious is that? And God, thank you for the hearts and the willingness of people to take a weekend, a Sunday, where most people clearly just sleep in, and sleep almost all day, just hang out. And but God, your people, they want to meet and gather and make space for you to continue to do this amazing work that you're doing here at Oakleaf that we give you all the glory for. You are great and greatly to be praised. And God, I ask again, would you do that threefold work? Would you illuminate our minds to the truth of your word, arrest our hearts to the truth of your word, and God, energize our wills to respond to the truth of your word, all that you might be magnified and glorified and your kingdom would be advanced for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. Yeah, give it up for our band again. Come on now. Our production in the back, they're nailing it. All right, to get us started today, I've got a little video that I would like for you guys to enjoy just for a moment here. Scary. Ugly.
The mechanized breathing. The threatening voice.
What have you done?
The frightening mask. Central to the Star Wars saga, Darth Vader is widely regarded as one of cinema's greatest villains, with a haunting, iconic look and menacing presence. While he finds his way back to the side of good, the legacy of Darth Vader, Sith Lord, prevails.
It is useless to resist. Soon the rebellion will be crushed.
On the surface, a seemingly honorable politician with no great ambition, but underneath
Evil.
The facade, a Sith mastermind determined to rule the galaxy. In his rise to power, Darth Sidious manipulates those around him to become Supreme Chancellor. He orchestrates a war, playing both sides effortlessly. He lures the Chosen One to the dark side, using him to help destroy the Jedi Order. And he hatches a multi-layered trap to destroy the Rebellion. When he has to get his hands dirty, Sidious welcomes combat and shows no mercy. There is no one as calculating, deceitful, or joyfully evil as the Emperor. And that's why we rank him number one.
Ugly, 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 ugly. I know other Star Wars people in the room may feel a little different than I do, but did I get it up? Did I get it wrong? Did I get the order of that right from villain to villain? Did I pretty much nail it? Okay. Well, I need you to know that I didn't in the beginning because I told Joy as she was going to work the other day. I said, hey, I'm opening up with, you know, how our series is the helper, the real force that's really with us. And we're reaching into some of the George Lucas Star Wars stuff, and I'm gonna like name the villains from, you know, where, from the, you know, top five. And so I told her, you know, Jabba the Hutt, then Darth Maul, then Grievous, and then I actually gave Darth Vader 1 and 2. And she's like, "Oh, you can't do that. You can't do that." And then she began to tell me about the Emperor, and I was like, "You know what? I think I got it wrong." So now I got it right. So thank you, Joy, for helping me to get that right. Got a lot of thumbs up in the house about that. The whole thing about the evil forces and all that in Star Wars, I don't know if you know this, but George Lucas, the mastermind behind the Star Wars movie, one of the reasons he even did the movie is because he was concerned about a culture and a nation that had gone super science and forgetting that there are other forces that we cannot deny that are functioning. Man, he portrayed through sights and sounds and epic storytelling something that's very true about real life, and that's this. There are unseen evil forces warring against good forces. And I like to describe those forces in this way. This way I describe it. One force is like a full moon, and it pulls the tide of evil up within the human soul, flooding the heart with selfishness, greed, and power. The other, like a mother grizzly ferociously protecting her cubs. And the moms of the first ever said, amen. Ferociously protecting their cubs. It surges the heart with strength to see God triumphed over evil. Good triumphed over evil. The Apostle Paul described this very same thing in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, in the infallible, inerrant, inspired, authoritative word of God. Listen to what he said. And we've used this verse and have studied this verse throughout this series, but today we're launching into something that's going to be great for the next couple of weeks. But listen to what he says. for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Notice he didn't leave it there. We do not wrestle. We do wrestle, amen. But we don't do it against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Now, if you've been in church for any length of time, then you're familiar with that verse, and you have at some level an understanding of a thing called spiritual warfare. And if you've not been in church, well, now you know. Amen. There is this thing. It is real. But when it comes to the concept of spiritual warfare, most churches prefer to think of it in a very controlled, predictable, and very tidy way versus the way that the Bible describes it. So I'm going to give you kind of an overview of an understanding of the spiritual warfare thing. Are you ready for it? You ready for it? Say yeah? Yeah? You ready? Okay, here it comes. Here's an understanding behind spiritual warfare. Satan and his dark evil forces are out to steal, kill, and destroy you, your family, and your loved ones. That's a fact. As a matter of fact, let's look at several places in the Bible where we see that Satan and his dark evil forces can and will adversely affect our lives. Ephesians 4:26, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. How many of you have ever heard that before? Raise your hands if you've ever heard that before. Yeah, we know that, right? People will say that, not even in church, they go, the Bible says don't you go to bed angry, amen. Well, that's one little tidy way of doing it. We forget about the back end of this thing, because it said this, and give no opportunity to the what? Read it, the what? The devil. See, this presupposes that the devil is intently looking for opportunities, and he will take them every time. So we got to beware. Jonathan McReynolds says in his song, Cycles, it's a great guy. You need to go listen to this guy. Incredible. He's got a little line, and it says this, Satan will learn from your mistakes, even if you don't. So we better beware. This force is really working. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 20, listen to this. He says, no, I imply what pagan sacrifice they offered to what? Come on, say it, read and follow along with me. They offered to what? Demons and not to God. He says, I do not want you to be participants with what? Demons. See, the Apostle Paul, who wrote 14 books of the Bible, I believe he wrote Hebrews, so I'm adding that in there. It's up to debate, but not for me. I believe he wrote that. But he is informing us here that demons are real and are working to hijack our innate desire to worship. See, look at me. We are wired to worship. We're wired to worship. That shows up in songs that we listen to. That shows up in different things that we are attracted to. Like, if you don't believe that we're wired for worship, what about what happened yesterday with a bunch of people that called themselves the Bulldogs? There's a lot of worship going on with this, man. We are the Bulldogs, and we're a college team. And if you don't, and it's not just here, it's all over the country. Like, why do people get so passionate? And men, literally, it's a matter of worship. Enjoy the games. There's nothing wrong with that. Have fun. But watch out, because what we do is we have a desire to elevate, we have a desire to idolize, and we have a desire to give other things this major energy. And we see here that Satan actually wants to hijack our innate desire to worship. Listen to this, 1 Timothy 4:1. The Spirit clearly says that in latter times, some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by what? Demons. Wow. Timothy, a first century evangelist, is giving us some major intel about the spiritual world. Namely, it has demons that specialize in spiritual deception. And they're so good at it, they beguile people to abandon Jesus. All I'm saying is we better take this serious. I look at 2 Timothy 2:26, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the what? Devil, who has taken them captive to do his will. You understand what's going on there? Here's young but wise Timothy dropping some more covert spiritual intelligence on us, revealing that Satan, the top commander-in-chief of all evil, has set traps, people have been captured by them, and they're being duped into advancing his kingdom of darkness. Wow. Most people, when they hear that, they automatically think political, like a political party. Well, if you do, you got to include all of them, okay? You got to include all of them, because literally Satan is behind anything that's happening on the planet, and his desire is to take things down and advance his kingdom of darkness. James 3:14, listen to this. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. That wisdom doth not descend from above, but it's earthly, sensual, and what? Demonic. See, here is the half-brother of Jesus informing us that on earth, notice, not someplace down in hell, demons aren't in hell. Yet, that happens in the final judgment. Demons are here on earth, and they're making people through selfish intent and selfish interest redefine and resist truth, which ultimately will destroy them. So here are people that are all around the world would think, man, the world is crazy. And the way that they redefine this, they redefine that, they're restructuring this, redestructuring that. If you've ever thought that there's got to be something evil behind it all, yes, you're exactly right. We're told that right here in the Bible. Wow. Listen to this one, 2 Corinthians 4:4. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ. Now, what is that? Well, the phrase God of this world, first of all, I want you to know that it is a lowercase g, not an uppercase g. Amen. There is only one Jehovah who is all caps God. However, this God title means that Satan is a formidable supernatural foe who can put humans into an intellectual trance, a powerful distraction whereby they are blind to the very good news of the gospel. Meaning, he's hell-bent on stealing, killing, and destroying every person, keeping them from getting saved so that they will suffer with him, damned and doomed forever in hell. That's his goal. That's his mission. And he's relentless in it. Why do I bring all this up? We're talking about the helper, the real force that is really with us. Well, we better understand our adversary. See, most people, when asked about Satan, demons, and evil spirits, their minds immediately go to possession. They think of that kid who was being thrown into the fire. And the mom and dad reached out to Jesus, and Jesus took care of the problem, right? How many of you have ever heard that story? Oh, yeah, you've heard that story. Nod your head. Or they think about the demoniac guy that was living in the cemetery, right? And then he met Jesus, and then a bunch of demons came out of him, and they went into what? Say it. And then where did those swine go? They did what? They killed themselves. So we know this story. We know it. And because that's not where we see Satan primarily doing his worst to humanity, that's not where we see Satan doing his worst to humanity, but we limit it to that mostly. 90% of humans have never witnessed a possession. Perhaps maybe only in a movie, which makes it, in our minds, even more unlikely that Satan is real, therefore we dismiss it to our demise. The Bible says, do not be ignorant of the schemes of the devil. We have to address it. We dismiss it, all of it. And as a result, Satan wins the battle that's at stake because we're plugging our ears thinking it's fake. The Bible assures us it is not. Like, this is real. This is a real deal. This is really happening. And because we've not armed ourselves, and man, we're in great trouble. Now, let me read to you after hearing all of those verses. Now let me read Ephesians 6:12 again to you. Listen to it carefully. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. See, that's not all like stained glass, you know, warm house lights, sing-along Christianity, is it? Not at all. And some people are like, hey, man, hold on, preacher, time out now, hold on a second. I came here to get encouraged. Like, I came here to get encouraged, but now I'm hearing that I'm susceptible to Satan and demons and evil spirits. That's not exactly the Hallmark Sunday morning make-me-feel-good moment that I was looking for. I fully understand it. But don't worry, there is good news. There is incredible good news. If I just shared everything that I just shared with you right now, and I just said, and amen, be dismissed. You guys would go eat somewhere like, it's just like, hey, what happened to you? Well, I went to church. You know, is this all bad news? No, listen, there is incredible good news. As a matter of fact, remember, that's one of our core values as a church. We got three things. We got really just two things that we're doing well. Share good news, doing good deeds. That's what Jesus said. Share good news, do good deeds, all for the greatest cause. The greatest cause ever, and that being Jesus and his great kingdom. But there is good news, and here's the good news. You ready for it? I'm going to define it just a little bit for you, but redefine it a little bit. But here it is. The good news is Jesus came to earth to put a holy, hiney whooping on the devil. Come on, quote unquote, baby. Amen. That is the fact. That is truth. That is what happened. Listen to this. Hebrews 2:14 breaks it down for us. So therefore, the children share in flesh and blood. He himself, Jesus, likewise partook of the same thing, that is flesh and blood, that through death he might destroy the one who had the power of death, that is the who? You know what that's saying? Jesus, God, came, took on human flesh for the purpose of destroying the devil. So if we don't really deal with this, then we're not really understanding the full glory of the gospel and the power of Jesus. Listen to this. This is Colossians 2:15. He, Jesus, disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them through the cross. Amen. Pastor's emphasis added right there. Listen to this. I love it. You can hear the holy hiney kicking all in John 10:10. It's so good, right? The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I love that Jesus didn't leave it right there. He said, I have come. And aren't we glad he did? Amen. He said, I have come that they might have life. Who are they? Those who have been on the other end of the devil stealing, killing, and destroying. He came that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Amen. You know what that verse means? You know what that verse means? You get this down inside your soul. You should write it down, get it in you, go listen to it again. Just get this down and say it all the time. Listen, Satan seeking whom he may devour is no match for a Savior seeking whom he may deliver. We win. Amen. Like, we went, yes, it's ugly, yes, it's scary, yes, it's weird, yes, it's global, the forces are strong, they're powerful. Look at the world, open your eyes. Is this just humans just being human? No! There is an evil force behind all of it. He's not going to win, amen. He is not going to, I love Revelation. Let's just fast forward a little bit. Go, fast forward. Revelation chapter 12, 10 and 11, this is so good. For the accuser of our brothers has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. And they have conquered. Everybody say conquered. Yeah, I love the way you said that. They have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Come on, man. Amen. The blood of the Lamb. I love that. Tammy and I, this past week, we've been listening to some old school Bill Gaither music, and man, it's pretty incredible. The harmonies and stuff, like these guys open up with those harmonies, it's so incredible. But the hymns are so powerful. One of them, this reminds me of one called There's Power in the Blood. Oh, it is so good, it's so good. Listen to the first one. It said, would you be free from the burden of sin? Let me tell you something. On your own, fat chance, not gonna happen. You will never, never get victory over sin on your own. That's so discouraging. But there's power in the blood. There's power in the blood. Listen to this. Would you over evil a victory win? Fat chance, good luck. Take the devil on your own. Not going to happen. But there's wonderful working power in the blood. Amen. Isn't that good? That's how we conquer him. By the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. Man, that's so good. Now, even though all this is true, I got to tap the brakes just a little bit. Because Jesus came to earth and, yes, ignominiously humbled Satan. But right now, Satan, evil spirits, and demons have not received their ultimate judgment yet. That's coming right before or at the great white throne judgment mentioned in Revelation 20. Till then, we will constantly have to deal with the attacks. as I mentioned in the verses that I shared that explained Ephesians 6:12 in deeper detail. Not the greatest of news to hear in church. I understand. But if you're saved, if you've been redeemed, if you're converted, if you're regenerated, if you've been born again, then when they being the evil spirits, Satan and the demons, when they come against us, the church, Christ believers, we should remind them and remind ourselves that we are children of God. I mean, we're children of God. I really do this week, it's like God was saying to me, Tony, you don't really get it that you're a child of God. You don't quite have it all together. Galatians 3:26 says, for we are all sons and daughters of God through faith in Christ Jesus. But we don't quite get that. We really don't quite get that, the power that's behind it. But the animal kingdom gives us a great picture of what it means that we are sons and daughters of God. I want you to watch this video. Got a little baby, mama? Got a lion. Oh no, don't you mess with my child. Satan calls for backup. Now look at all of them. It's on. Looks like they win. Take it. Hey, come on. Isn't that so good? Isn't that so good? I was making that this week, and man, every time I was making it, I was just preaching it to myself like, I am a son of God. God the Father has his eyes on me. God the Father has his eyes on you. The Son has his eyes on you. The Spirit has his eyes on you. And I think of it like this. I was looking for a little thing about parents and children, and I couldn't believe how many videos showed up with, like, little kids by a pool. And like, there's a fence by the pool, but the little kid gets in. The little baby gets into the fence. And it was absolutely amazing how many dads, like, busted through the sliding glass window. Like, douche, just busted through it. Jump in the pool and grab that little baby up by the neck. Like, okay, got my baby. I mean, it's like God was saying, that's it. I'm always watching. I'm always there. And I'm not going to let the devil get victory over my children. You are my child. And if we watch over our kids, you think about the Heavenly Father watching over you, man. He is watching. Yes, we will suffer tribulation. Jesus said so. But be of good cheer. He has overcome the world. Man, that's good stuff. Come on now. Amen. So listen, when you feel the devourer's breath on your neck, that means he's close. So if he's close, take the opportunity to shout 1 John 4:4 in his face. I dare you. Come on, man. What does it say? I've added a little pastor emphasis to it to make it personal. I am from God. I'm his child. I will overcome you because greater is he who is in me than he that is in the world. Get you some of that, Satan. Amen. And if that's not enough to get your Sunday Hallmark encouraging moment, then remember that in addition to 1 John 4:4, we have been given authority over demons. Luke 9:1, then he, Jesus, called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all demons. Could some people say, well, wait a minute, Pastor, turn time out now. Hold on a second. Time out now. That authority was only for the apostles, and that season is over. Think about what you're saying. What? You're saying we're still in war. We all agree with that. If you agree we're at war, say yes. So we all agree that we're at war, but you're saying God only gave us 12 guys to do the fighting, and they're all dead? So we just got to run and hide from Satan? No, never. Go listen to week 2 of this series, and you'll learn that the Bible debunks that false teaching because Jesus gave it to 70 guys, and they weren't apostles. Gave it to 70 followers. And then, okay, if it was just for the apostles, then what about Philip? The evangelist, not Philip, the disciple, Philip the evangelist, the first century evangelist, he knew God gave authority over evil spirits, and he used it. Look at Acts 8, 6 through 7. And the multitudes with one accord heeded the things spoken by Philip. Hearing and seeing the miracles which he did, for unclean spirits crying out with a loud voice came out of many who were possessed. You see, God gave us power, and evil has to cower. For whatever reason, I think poor teaching in the church over the last 50 years, and that's week number one. You got to watch week number one series. We've so seen a particular group of people misuse the Spirit that it caused us to shake loose from the Spirit. And Satan went right where I need him. And so he kills the family, he kills the marriages, he kills the relationships with children, he kills the churches, right? The statistics are ridiculous. In 1950, 80% of America went to church. Today, 20% go, 25. But what's worse is 80% of Americans believe that the church is incompetent to help people. They're saying God can't help people. What's going on? We don't understand the power that we've got. Amen. And we don't have to get all whooped on by the devil. Will we have scratches, and will we have a bloody nose, and will our knees ache from praying? Absolutely. But we don't have to cower by the devil. I love this. This is so good. This is great. There's a story with the Apostle Paul, and he's preaching the gospel, and there's a demon-possessed person, a girl following him. And all she's doing is repeating what he's saying. But it was discrediting the message because she was not credible. So we get Acts 8, 6, and 7. This is awesome. No, Acts 16, 18. This is great. But Paul, greatly annoyed. If you ever get greatly annoyed at evil, that's okay. You're in good company right there. Greatly annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out that very hour. So let me rewind what I said earlier. God has given us power, so evil has to cower. Evil has to cower within the hour. Why are we the ones that have to wait, I don't know. The power is the evil, and the evil gets overcome us. Where did we buy into that? I tell you what happened is Satan fed us a bunch of junk, and we believed it because we would much rather just have that tidy, nice, predictable, controlled idea of Christianity. But the reality is not like that at all. Another practice and powerful tactic to employ is to proclaim out loud the power of the gospel over darkness. The gospel itself has power. When Jesus commissioned Paul to preach among the Gentiles, he said this, that they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to who? Say it again, to who? Isn't that great? Satan doesn't stand a chance, man. God will build his church and Satan doesn't stand a chance. I love Romans 1:16. It says this, for I am not ashamed of the gospel. Why? Because it is the power of God. Well, I don't know if my friend ever gets saved. I'm just going to share the gospel. I'm just going to simply tell him the story of the gospel. And we bought the lie of the devil. The gospel is powerful. And it breaks through. Sometimes it takes time. Sometimes it takes prayer and fasting. But the gospel is powerful. I love that. It's the power of God that brings salvation to who? Everyone. Everyone who believes. I don't know if he'll ever come. I don't know if she'll ever come. I don't know. Why do we start with that? Why is that where we start? Well, you don't know how bad he is. He's so far. She's so far. Why do we start with that? Why not going, oh, my word, this person is going to get walloped with the love of God. Can we understand the power of the gospel? We'll do it that way. Oh, so good. Also remind the devil Jesus came and conquered him. That's why he came. John 3:8, the reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. Remember over there in Genesis 3:15, the proto-evangelion, first time the gospel was preached, it was preached by God to Satan. And it said basically something like this. Okay, you've come and you've interfered, but I'm sending my son through the seed of a woman. You're going to bruise his heel, but he's going to crush your head. You're done. Galatians 4:4, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, born of a virgin. Why did Jesus come? Well, we often would think, well, because it'd save us from our sins. True. But he had some unfinished business to attend to. God had done preached something and declared something and spoke something, and he was coming to carry it out. And he did. Come on, somebody. He did. He defeated the devil. This is so good. You need to tell him this, too. This is great. Colossians 1:13 and 14. He, Jesus, what has delivered me from the power of darkness and conveyed me into the kingdom of the love of his son. You need to tell Satan that. You need to tell every demon in hell that. It's in the Bible. He has delivered me from the power of darkness and conveyed me into the kingdom of the son of his love. I'm going to give you a little exercise. Can I give you a little exercise to do this week? Okay, let me give you a little exercise. You ought to write this verse on your hand. You ought to write this verse on your hand. Left hand, right hand, I don't care. Write it on your hand. Write the whole verse on your hand. He, Jesus, has delivered me from the power of darkness and conveyed me, transferred me into the kingdom of the Son of his love. You ought to write that down on your hand and read it all day tomorrow. And when Satan attacks, shove it in his face like this. Come on, somebody, come on. Why do we just think, no, we just need to let him keep shoving stuff in ours? What? Where is that? But Jesus was meek. Meekness is power under control. He never allowed Satan to flip his power where he used it for his own personal gain. I have come to do the will of the Father. But he was never not powerful. And he never cowered to evil. And he looked at us and he said, greater works will you guys do. But where's that? Where's that? I think it's coming. I think there's a wave coming. There's a movement coming where God is going, you know what? It's getting crazy. It's getting awful. The prophetic timetable is happening in front of our very eyes, and the church will rise up in power. Amen. We win. But for now, we are in the battle. So we best learn how to live in victory, the victory that Jesus secured for us. James and Peter give the best streamlined details on how we do this. We're going to live in victory that God secured for us. Listen to this. I love this. James 4:7. Submit to God. Resist the devil. And he what? What's the word? What's the word before that? He what? Say it again. You got to believe that. He will flee from you. Submitting to God. And then be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Most people who quote that stop right there. But the rest of it says, resist him steadfast in the faith. Did you notice the word resist in both of these verses? To resist means to return fire. Satan makes it a point to fight us a certain way, and we counter his shots with a few rounds of our own done in the power of the Spirit. The power of your flesh, you're going to get whipped up on, but you do it in the power of the Spirit. And by the way, you've got the power of the Spirit. He's a real helper, a real force that's really with you. Romans 8:11. But if, it should be, the word since should be in the Greek, it's since. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. That's not talking about you're going to die and you're going to live again. That's over there in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. This is talking about you living, but you're living with the power of God in you. What kind of power? Resurrection power. It spoke, Jesus came back from the dead. That's in us. That Spirit is in us. It's in us. One of the best battle plans to help us gain an edge over our enemy through the power of the Spirit is found in Galatians 5:16-23. Let me just read it to you. I didn't put it on the screen. I just want you to listen to it. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh, which we'll talk about next week. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. Don't you think that that might be one of the greatest battlefields that Satan will try to take us on right there? If you know there's already a battle, you can count on it. This is crazy. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things that you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies. And then it says this, and things like these. There's not an exhaustive list here. How could there be? The flesh manifests itself in just crazy, crazy, crazy ways. And then he says this, I warn you, as I've warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. And then he flips it, because you're like, oh my gosh, I could think that I've done several of those. I'm done. I'm in trouble. Then he says this, but the fruit of the Spirit, remember, be led by the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is, and it counters all that other stuff, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such thing, there is no law. Why did he say that against such thing as there is no law? Well, there's a lot to it in Galatians, but primarily Satan will attack you using the law and the rules and the regulations of God. He follows all those things. That's why when Jesus died on the cross, he used the word tetelestai. Why did he say that? He was just saying that? No, he was declaring something to Satan, who knows, okay, God, this is the legal right. This is the written law. This is the written document in heaven. Somebody's got to die, and somebody pure has to die. God's truth. Doesn't happen, everybody's done. This has got to happen. And Satan always tried to, like, thwart Jesus from doing that all the time. So when Jesus dies, he goes, tetelestai. What? An accounting term that means what? Paid in full. That legal thing, I paid it in full. So see, when you're operating in your flesh, Satan can use everything against you, every truth, every to use it all against you. By the way, that's what Satan does. You know what he does? He'll serve you some truth to feed you a lie. That's what he does. He's very subtle in the way he does it. But man, he doesn't win when it comes to this. We'll be studying these verses, Galatians, and the fruit of the Spirit for the next 3 weeks. Today was to get us ready for it. Now, with a proper understanding of our enemy, his tactics, his viciousness, his relentlessness, we'll study and embrace Galatians 5:16-23 like our very lives depend on it. If I'd have just brought up Galatians 5:16-23, we'd have approached it just like we do any normal little Bible study. We're just getting some more information. That's nice to do, checking off my box. But listen to me, your very life depends on it. It depends on it. It does depend on it, because as to whether we're going to live a life where Satan still kills and destroys us so easily because we walk in the flesh, or we can have a life where through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can tap into the abundant life that Jesus offers us. I want that. Do you want that? I know you do, man. I do. I want it so bad. And I want it for our whole faith family. And it's here for us. It is here for us. We just got to grab it. Use it. The band can come out. Come on out. This is so great. I heard a story whenever I was in Texas going to school about a Texas high school football team. The team was made up of the smallest and slowest players in the division. They had a quarterback that could not throw. Don't think about your team right now. Don't think about your team. But they had a quarterback that could not throw. And even on rare occasions when he got a pass off, the receivers couldn't catch. They just couldn't catch. However, the crowds at the games were amazing. The stands were packed every game, cheering at the top of their lungs. The high school marching band was always fired up, and the cheerleaders cheered wildly. Why? Why, when they were so small and slow and horrible at throwing and couldn't catch? Because on every fourth down, the cheerleaders would get the crowd pumped. Every person in attendance for the team would stand to their feet, clanging cowbells, flipping towels, and blowing horns. And the cheerleaders would chant, "You got him, now use him. You got him, now use him. You got him, now use him." And then the crowd would join them and roar, "You got them, now use them. You got them, now use them." And then it would happen. From the bench stood their weapon, Bruno, a 17-year-old, 6'8", 390-pound non-starter, who on every fourth down would be given the ball and told to just walk toward the end zone. And every time that massive hunk of a boy would get the ball, bodies piled up on top of him till you couldn't even see him anymore. His cadence would slow, but his movement still went forward, no matter how far they were from the goal. The pile of sweaty, screaming opponents kept creeping yard by yard, inch by inch, till they finally cross the end zone. Then, in a fevered frenzy, the team, the crowd, and the cheerleaders would yell, "We got him, we used him. We got him, we used him. We got him, we used him. Score!" I think you know where I'm going with this. Oak Leaf, we're a lot like that team. There's nothing really special about any of us here. Any moment, any time, any second, we will fail in our flesh. But we have the power of the Holy Spirit on our team. We've got him. Now use him. We've got him. Now use him. We've got him. Now use him. And no matter how high the demon and devil count gets on top of us, no matter how slow our cadence might get, oh, we will forge forward and we will stand victorious. Stand with me, would you? Father, we bless you and we praise you that you are so thoughtful, supremely intelligent and wise, and you give us the gift of the precious Holy Spirit. Father, as we have studied the devil and Satan and the evil spirits, we have not in any way elevated them. Christ Jesus, you are elevated above all principalities and powers. Clearly, I have stated the devil doesn't stand a chance. And we thank you, God, that we are not fighting for victory, we're fighting from it. But you tell us we've got to be engaged in this. And to not be appropriately engaged, we're just giving it over to Satan. That will never be the heartbeat of our church. Thank you for giving us what we need. Spirit of God, we thank you. We've got you, and we will use you. And you're going to help us to be victorious for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
You've got a lion inside of those lungs.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
To those around me. How great you are, how great. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great. My soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art.
Guys, thank you for worshiping us this morning. We appreciate it. I hope you have a blessed week. Thank you.